Hey there, everyone. This is Samuel Johnson, and welcome back to the Ben 10 Retrospectives. And today, we're going to be talking about episode 38 of the original Ben 10 series, Be Afraid of the Dark. And if you've watched the last vlog or just watched the original show in general, then you know this episode is actually part two of the show's first two-part episode. And in the last episode, Ben, Gwen, and Max traveled to NASA because they had reports of a purple lightning attack. Striking and apparently grounding their latest space launch. So Ben, Gwen, and Max went to investigate, and it turns out that at the launch site is the werewolf from the Ben Wolf episode, the mummy from the Underass episode, and leading them is a new monster alien Frankenstein that was disguised as a scientist working at NASA named Victor. Apparently, all three of these people want the shuttle launched for some weird specific reason, so the Tennysons split up, with Gwen and Max attempting to go stop the launch manually because all the controls in the control room were locked, while Ben went to go battle the monsters, the Victor sent the werewolf back to New Mexico for some... sent the werewolf back to New Mexico, and then he... launched the shuttle with Gwen and Max inside it, as well as the mummy. And so when Ben starts questioning him, I'm gonna stop your plan. Victor says, "It's not my plan. It's my master's." And the camera panned up to show a chunk of the building of that academy that Gwen wanted to go to in the Ghost Freaked Out episode. And pretty much, yeah, his master is Ghostfreak, as he uses the technology of this lab to revive him. And worst yet, Ben was alien at this time, and so the Omnitrix times out, and that's where this episode picks up. Ben is running away from Victor and Ghostfreak as both are trying to corner him and get him, but Ben is just running all over the place. So Ben is able to ultimately save himself as the Omnitrix for some reason recharged quickly, and Ben is able to transform into gray matter and escape them. As Ben is just continually going around, Victor and Ghostfreak are still looking for them. Victor even questioning why they're even doing this, why they're even looking for Ben if they're so close to their plan. And Ghostfreak responds, tells him, and Ghostfreak, after doing to him what he did to Thumbskull when Thumbskull questioned him, states that the reason they're looking for Ben is because Ben can actually stop their plans despite how far they've come. So Ben can hear everything because he's kind of going in through, because he's going into all the little cracks and crevices of gray matter, and he's able, and so he wants, and so he manages to find his way to a computer console on another level of the building they're in, because they're in a giant unused shuttle, and Ben manages to use the console to communicate with the shuttle that's been launched into space, and Gwen and Max have gotten up to the launch controls inside the shuttle. And so Ben, found out what Ghostfreak's whole plan was and why he sent the werewolf and the mummy and Victor to all these places. It turns out that Ghostfreak's big plan is to get the corrodium shards that the mummy had up to this space station. At which point he would have the corrodium uploaded as some sort of energy, and have that energy beam down to a transceiver in New Mexico, which is why the werewolf in the Ben Wolf episode was stealing all that satellite equipment. He was building the transceiver that would get the signal, and thus when the beam hits the transceiver, it would send out a wide array of energy to two other satellites that would go back to the other station, and it would cause a giant wave of corrodium to cover the entire Earth and mutate everyone on it, though Ben states that apparently that might be a side effect, or maybe one side effect, I don't know. But bottom line, with the corrodium wave completely covering the Earth, the sun would be blocked out, darkness would reign, and Ghostfreak could be at full power at all times. However, before Ben can tell Gwen and Max more, the mummy comes and it grabs Gwen and Max, pulling them aside. And at that same time, on Ben's end, Victor and Ghostfreak have come down to his level. So Ben hides in the console, and So he realize, and so he decides that I need to find somebody to fend them off, so he gathers all these little spare parts for some in the console for something. Well, Gwen and Max fight off the mummy. Gwen tries using a spell, which causes her hazmat to expand into, like, her, make her ball. And she's able to fend off the mummy for about, I don't know, 8 seconds, I think. And but she winds up accidentally launching herself and Max into an airlock, which the mummy uses to eject them from the shuttle. They manage to make it out okay because their suits are magnetized and they're able to get and they're able to attach themselves to the outside of the space station. But Max states that magnetism won't work out in a zero atmosphere environment, so they have to get inside the space station. While at that same time as Ben, at that same time on Earth, the Omnitrix timed out and Ben is now back to normal, and so Victor finds him and rips him, throws him out of the console. And at the end, he grabs him by his wrist, too, so the Omnitrix samples Victor's DNA, which I'm bringing up now so I don't have to come back to it later. And Ghostfreak's about to possess Ben because still wants the Omnitrix, but it turns out Ben pulls out what he was building as Grey Manor. It turns out it was a miniature sun gun that he used to repel Ghostfreak. And Victor, so Victor, in rage, tries to kill Ben, but Ben is able to manipulate a cinder block to fly into Victor's face and knock him into some loose wires on the shuttle. And Ben, of course, and so Ben goes to all these he gets some more spare parts, but, and again, Omnitrix for some reason recharges very quickly in this episode as he's able to transform and upgrade and merge with a thruster. But Victor, for some reason, is not down. In fact, he has actually now taken something into his vaults. It looks like a giant laser, and so when Ben launches off, Victor grabs onto him. They start fighting each other as they're both going up. Back on the space station, Gwen and Max are able to get back inside. They find the mummy. He's downloaded the corrodium into the station and is now going to beam it down to New Mexico. But they are able to stop it. They're able to stop the mummy, but the mummy starts fighting back. But at the same time, Ben is there and he detaches from the thruster, causing Victor to just fly off into space. So Ben goes into the station, is able to knock off the mummy, is able to defeat the mummy, and the Omnitrix times out at that point. And after a kind of annoying conversation about Ben wanting a thank you or something, Max notices that realizes something's not right as they look over to the console and finds that the targeting reticle towards New Mexico is now working by itself. And it turns out that Ghostfreak also hitched a ride with Ben when he flew up here. So Ghostfreak redirects it. He causes the corrodium beam to fly to New Mexico. And Ghostfreak's plan is now pretty much enacted. It actually succeeds. It hits the beam down to Mexico. The werewolf is able to activate the transceiver. It beams a whole thing across, beams the wave across the Earth, and suddenly, at least everyone in New York or whatever is mutated into these grotesque monsters. At that point, Ghostfreak is able to free the mummy because they knocked it into a room, and so Ghostfreak is ready to throw all of the Tennysons. That includes Ben, because I suppose now that his big plan is a success, he doesn't want the Omnitrix anymore. I don't know. It's not really explained very well. But at that point, Gwen tricks Ghostfreak into having the mummy remove their hazmat suit so she can successfully create a spell that freezes the mummy. Now that he's free and again, Omnitrix recharges quickly. Ben goes alien, and we see his version of Victor, and we see the new alien that Ben got from Victor. He's called Ben Victor. Yeah, I will openly admit that's kind of not a creative name. In fact, I actually kind of would. In fact, I think his name Frankenstrike, which is the name they gave him in Omniverse, is better. But okay, you know, I'm still gonna call him Ben Victor for this one because, like Ben Wolf and Ben Mummy, he doesn't appear that often. In fact, this is his only appearance in the entire show, so whatever. So anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. Ben fights off Ghostfreak, and Ghostfreak pulls him outside the space station, and in the darkness of space, he's able to get to his full power, which is slightly bigger, has horns protruding out of his arms, the back of his hands, has his tentacles protruding out of his chest 24/7, makes his teeth sharp, and now he can shoot a laser out of his chest, as he does with Ben. As Ben Now, his electrical powers, thanks to his body, so and using his electromagnetic powers, he's able to stick to the outside. So they have a fight outside, but of course things are not going well. They can't inside the station. They can't it turns out Ghostfreak's frozen the controls. They can't fix everything. So Max takes the space shuttle and flies out and is ready to ram the ship right into the right into the station. But at that point, but at that exact same time, Victor comes back, still now somehow working the shuttle, working the thruster on his own, and starts blasting into them. He starts resisting, and all on the inside, Gwen has to fight the mummy as now it's unfrozen, and she manages to get it outside the shell using a toilet, which only brings the mummy outside to help Ghostfreak fight Ben. But Ben, however Max is able to outmaneuver Victor by turning his ship around and turning all of the thrusters, causing Victor to unintentionally throw Max right into the transceiver, destroying it and stopping the beam. Ghostfreak is, of course, notifiably pissed, but by doing so, this also frees Victor from the thruster. He also takes part in the fight, and he still uses his laser, and I don't know what he does. He shoots a laser into a section of space, and it opens what I can call, maybe I'll call a plot hole? I don't know. Maybe it's the same thing he did with the mummy when the werewolf. I got those kind of confused. Maybe it's the same thing he did with the werewolf when he sent him to New Mexico, but that's really what he does. It sucks in the mummy. It sucks in Victor. And because thanks to the Karate mean to being destroyed, the console that the werewolf was working on in New Mexico explodes. So I think he's dead. I don't know. They don't show him being destroyed. I think it's implied that he's dead. We never see him again. So I don't know. Maybe I don't know. I think he comes back in Omniverse. I don't know. I haven't watched that arc. But either way, anyway, and whatever. But whatever. Ben, now that those two, anyway, Victor and the mummy are taken care of. Ben's ready to fight Ghostfreak, but Ghostfreak has somehow vanished. But with the destruction of the transceiver, the station is blowing up. So Ben gets back inside, but before he can save Gwen, the Omnitrix times out, and so Gwen grabs a spare hazmat suit, wraps herself and Ben in it, and as the shuttle explodes, they're jettisoned into space, where Max finds them and gets all three of them their own separate hazmat suits. So they're flying to Earth. Ben is for some reason still being an ungrateful prick, as he says, "Oh, I think everything would have been better if you two just stayed out of it." Which I respond with, "Oh, kids, screw you." But at that, however, the episode is not over yet. And suddenly, Ghostfreak comes back because we didn't see him die. Something happened to him. And so, now that his plan is spoiled, he decides to go back to getting the Omnitrix. He tries to possess Ben, but he brings him into the back of the shuttle. And it turns out that Gwen and Max have their own plan. As Gwen opens up the back of the shuttle, Max flies the shuttle close to the sun. And so, at the back of the being that close to the sun, Ghostfreak is destroyed again. But the shuttle, upon entering Earth's atmosphere, it has retained too much damage from hitting the space station satellite. So they're gonna crash. So Ben is able to go cannonbolt, and is able to go to Earth at high speeds, able to withstand the intense heat. He's able to save Gwen and Max. And at that point, he finally does acknowledge that maybe they are good as a team. I don't know, it just doesn't feel right. So they put their hands in the middle, and they just think that they're never going to have to deal with the Ghostfreak again, but the Omnitrix, again, recharges quickly, and it shows a silhouette for Ghostfreak. And not just Ghostfreak the way he was before, you know, white skin, single eye and everything. No, it's original Ghostfreak. Upside down skull head, claw fingers, that's the Ghostfreak that's now on Ben's Omnitrix. So Ben has Ghostfreak back, though he never uses him. I can understand why. It's just that I kind of feel strange. Just kind of feel strange to have him back in the Omnitrix. I suppose it's so that Ben's alien count can go back up one, so that you can still say he technically has all of his originals still. But I don't know. It really just kind of feels tacked on. We never see Ghostfreak appear again in the original series until Alien. And in fact, the Ghostfreak's sixth appearance is in Alien 4. So I don't know. Just kind of feels strange. So, and the episode pretty much ends with Ben, Gwen, and Max in Egypt. It's never explained how, and it's not explained how they go back to America. I assume they took a plane and then took several buses back to NASA to get back to the rust bucket, but I don't know. Next episode, they're back in America, so. Yeah, like, so, based on my reaction, I love this two-parter. It's a great two-parter. I actually think it's my favorite so far out of the finales. I think behind this is the season one finale, and then after that, it's Back with a Vengeance. But I think out of all of these, it's this one I think is the best. And I think what helps make it work is that unlike the other finales, it feels like there's more weight to it. Like, in Secrets, there was weight to it. It was still some good weight. It was a good build-up, because in Secrets, it was a very nice build-up to Vilgax. Because you had episodes with him sending things down to Earth, and it wasn't that often, but you saw little things here and there, and you knew that eventually... And you were just waiting for Vilgax to heal and go down to Earth and fight Ben in person, and you knew that was coming. You knew that was coming, and you were always just waiting for it to happen, and admittedly... And it was an awesome payoff. But I think the difference between this storyline and that one is the fact that this one keeps you guessing. I think because in the Vilgax for Secrets, you knew what the payoff was. You knew it was Ghost. You knew that eventually Vilgax would free himself and have to battle Ben. You just knew. It's just that you knew that when that occurred, you were in for one hell of a battle, and that's exactly what you got. In this one, the build-up was subtle. Like, when we got to the Ben Wolf episode, I mentioned before that you didn't know anything about what the werewolf was doing. You didn't know why it was stealing that satellite equipment. You don't know why it wanted it. When you saw what it was doing, you were wondering, what's that for? They don't explain. They don't actually explain that. It's the same with the mummy. When it appears and it's going after the Corodium, you're wondering, why does it want it? Why is it going to such efforts to get it? Why is it doing all this? And then when you finally get to this episode, you suddenly learn that they were connected beyond... That the mummy and the werewolf were actually connected. It helped pay everything off, and the introduction of Victor just made everything work. As they didn't answer all the questions. Even in the last part, they still left everything vague. You wanted to know what was going on, and this episode admittedly answered most of the questions well. They explained why the werewolf was going after the satellite equipment. It needed a transceiver for the Corodium beam. It explained why the mummy was going after the Corodium. It needed it to shoot the beam. And it explained why Victor was so determined at the shuttle launch, because they needed to get a rocket to get up to the space station. It's a good build-up. It's done small. Like, there were two episodes before this two-parter, but they leave enough in the dark so that you want to know what happened, so you're hoping that it's answered later. And really, it works. It really does work. I think, again, it really is a good... It really does work. And both of these episodes, ironically, I did think they do tell a good story. Like, you start getting hints that there's more to it. You get hints of what's more to it with their introduction of Victor and all that stuff. You see all of these monsters together, and ending it with Ghostfreak. It really does help you want to watch the second episode. And the second episode is almost all action. Like, you see, but it from the very minute it starts, it's really just a chase and a fight. It's chase and fights, and you're okay with dealing with it. Because you saw all the story building up to it. All that's been set up. And so now you have this episode where everyone is running. Everyone's fighting. It's a grand plot that encompasses the whole Earth. You know you have to keep watching. And it is so. And there's so much happening throughout it. Everyone, the main three are always doing something. Ben is dealing with the monsters. Max and Gwen are trying to find a way to shut down the shuttle. Each of them are going at it from different angles. It really is fun because everyone is doing something, and everyone has something to gain. Everyone has something to offer, and it really is great. And it's just fun. I love it. It's a great action-packed story with all these awesome things going in. It is, in fact, I love this. It's a good it's a good payoff, and I think it works. Before I go nuts, I want to at least talk about Ben Victor, because again, new alien, I have to talk about him. As I stated at the end of the vlog, I think the biggest flaw with him is the fact that he only appears once. But otherwise, I think this episode actually kind of convinced me. I think rewatching this episode now does convince me that he is pretty cool. Like, he actually is a competent fighter. He still looks threatening, and he does, again, like Ben's own versions. It still has enough of the original source DNA because he's pretty much an exact body double of Victor, with the only difference being that He has hair that's actually wavy, and sideburns. Both of his eyes are normal sized, and his lightning is green instead of purple. So there's that. And he's a very competent fighter. His electric powers are actually used rather well. I actually think Ben Victor is a pretty cool alien. But again, he shares the same problems that Benwolf and Benwomi have, that he's very much underutilized and does not appear very often. This is his only appearance in the entire show. This is his only appearance, which kind of irks me, like, a lot. But anyway, I think I'm done going nuts over everything, because we're 20 minutes in. I spent a lot of time summarizing the plot there. I'm sorry, but we're 20 minutes in, and I still haven't touched everything I want to talk about. Like, and I think one of those things that I'm going to talk about is what I genuinely disliked, which is kind of, which again, I love this two-parter. It's my favorite. It's a great finale. But there are problems. Not very prevalent problems, but still problems. For starters, Ben. Ben, in this two-parter, is an arrogant prick. And I know that's part of Ben's character. He's full of himself. He's arrogant. He likes the glory of being a hero. Okay, fine. That's part of his character. He's 10 years old in this regard. But in this two-parter, he's a lot more arrogant than usual. Outright disregarding Max and Gwen and all their contributions. It's not nice. And it kind of feels... It feels out of character, ironically. Like, again, I know Ben can be arrogant, but to the point where he actively thinks that Ben and Gwen are hindrances and this should only be dealing with cleanup? I don't like that. Especially since in many episodes prior to this one, they have done more than just cleanup. Max's plumber... If it wasn't for Max on several occasions, Ben would be high and dry with certain things. Like, his plumber history, saving him from Vilgax. All of that plumber stuff has helped Ben in the past, and Gwen has provided great intelligence, actually is a skilled fighter, and has taken part in several things. And has taken part in several fights. It's just that, for some reason, in this two-parter, Ben is more arrogant. And it doesn't work. It feels out of place and forced. It feels forced. I don't get it. And I think what's really kind of... And what makes this problem even more worse... I think what makes this problem worse is the fact that Ben never... What was I talking about? Oh, yeah. It's the fact that it doesn't really amount to anything. At all. Like, okay, you can say the climax was kind of amount to that because it shows them being active and all that, but here's the thing. We've seen them do this throughout the entire show. We've seen them be active. We've seen them do things. We've seen them do their part in helping save the world. This is nothing new. It's just that for some reason, Ben seems to ignore it. In the first part of this two-parter, in The Return, he seems to be... Ironically, it seems to get worse. In the first part, it is out of place and just feels weird, the fact that Ben seems to think that, oh, I'm the better of the... better, you two just sit on the sidelines and wait for me. And in this one, he's a prick! I'm sorry, I'm swearing, but he's a prick! He calls them out? I don't understand this! What the heck, kid? What the heck? Like, they're doing all this useful stuff, and his reaction is, oh, whatever, I could have done it all in my sleep. Oh, come on! Really, kid? Really? I know I'm getting on this, and again, he's 10 years old. I know I shouldn't be getting mad about this, but it feels out of character. Again, and it's not that Ben's arrogant or Ben's full of himself. Yeah, that's a part of his character. He's 10. But in previous episodes, he has appreciated their work. He has appreciated the help they've given him. He has thanked them for that. For some reason, this episode, his dick meter goes from 1 to 1,000. I don't understand that. And I'm sorry, I'm going nuts. It just feels out of place, and what makes it worse is the fact that it doesn't factor into anything except for the happy moment at the end of the two-parter. That's it. The first half, it doesn't really affect the overall plot, and in this one, there's so much stuff happening that it barely has any effect at all. And it really it's really annoying. I don't really understand it. And another problem I have with that is Victor, too. Like, again, I'm not saying that he's a bad character. Far from it. I think he actually is an effective villain. He has a demanding presence. He can actually think intelligently. And in fact, it's actually stated in one in one of Ben Victor's bios, or Frankenstein, whatever, Ben Victor's bios, that aside from his strength and electrical powers, he's also smart too, like gray matter. And Victor also actually helps exemplify that. Well, not in the second part. In the first part, he is that way. He does feel like the mastermind. He actually does feel like a grand schemer. In the second part, when Ghostfreak comes in, the spotlight's kind of robbed from him. He feels more like a grunt. He acts a bit more dumb. When Ghostfreak starts insulting him, he seems to have more blank expression, like, duh? He seems to be a bit more rough. He just seems... He feels like he's been degraded. And it gets worse after he starts adding attachments to his back. He stops talking altogether, just roaring and attacking. And admittedly, he still is a viable threat. He still is a good fighter and all that. And we do get to see that. It's just that for the first third of the episode, he just seems to be picking stuff up like, I don't know. It feels like he got downgraded from the last part. I don't understand that. It really kind of feels weird. I think the final problem I have with this episode is, ironically, the same problem I had with the Big Tick. Namely, you have these huge world implications. Like, in the Big Tick, it was the world rotting from the inside out. Here, the entire Earth, or at least half of it, I think, is coated in this beam that mutates all life into these monsters. And yet, for some reason, no one, it's never acknowledged again. At all. In fact, that's kind of... you can probably make the argument that maybe no one remembers it. Well, at least they should be reporting on mass blackouts or something. Because suddenly everyone, for some reason, just blacks out, and then when they wake up, their clothes are shredded. I think that would get on the news, at least. And yet, it's never brought up again. It's not even explained how the Tennysons get back to America. I assume they took a plane, but it's not shown. As in the next episode, back in America, back to the status quo. It's not really acknowledged that well. And, oh yeah, there's also one more complaint. I think my biggest complaint is with Ghostfreak. And this isn't a big thing, but it does kind of feel strange. Mainly, in the beginning, when Ghostfreak returns, he goes back to what he was doing before, trying to get the Omnitrix. Well, once his plan succeeds, he stops going for the Omnitrix. He's ready to let Ben die, even though in the beginning of the episode he said he needs Ben's alive, he wants to merge with him. Well, and again, it's a small thing, because you can probably make the argument that Ghostfreak doesn't think Ben is needed anymore, since his plan is a success, the Earth is coated in darkness, the Podbus have been mutated, his plan's a success, why does he need the Omnitrix now? So, yeah, you can probably make... it's a small complaint, a nitpick at best. But it does. But it was. I think it's enough that I can bring it up. But otherwise, aside from those hiccups, yeah, it's a damn good two-parter, and I think it works well as a two-parter. As it technically a four-parter, if you want to count Ben Wolf and Under Wraps, it's a good, because it has awesome build-up. It leaves enough question. It leaves enough questions so that when they are answered, it feels satisfactory. Though there are still some questions that are not answered, like how is Ghostfreak able to plan this, which you have to look up supplemental material to read that. It's got awesome action sequences. It's got awesome it has awesome fight scenes. It has great buildup. It has a great way of building everything on top of each other. Just overall, it's a kick-ass finale, and I cannot recommend it more. So yeah. Awesome episode! Awesome two-parter! Go watch it! I don't know how to end this. I suppose I can still say thank you for watching. I'm glad you were able to sit through me going nuts again, and tune in next week as we look at what is the real finale for Season 3, as this episode answered the story arc, but next week is the finale of Season 3, and so... Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoy my first half-hour-long vlog. I didn't think it would get this long until the movies, but yeah, half-hour-long. I hope you enjoyed it. See you next week. Take care.